I'm here to fuck the shit out of JonTron. Hey, how's it going, everybody? David here, or I should say Spartan, actually. And I'm here to play something that I've never played before, a dating sim. Not just any dating sim, Asagao Academy, Normal Boots Club. I'm here to fuck the shit out of JonTron. Alright, enough of that. Again, I've never actually played a dating sim before. I've seen them, you know, they're in anime and all that. It's kind of like a pop culture kind of thing, anime culture, all of that. So let's go ahead and get in with this. Play. Chapter 1, bitch. Is that me? Damn, I'm fine. The train made its way along the gentle curve of the coast of Japan, whisking me farther and farther from home. Across from me sat a boy, face half buried in a newspaper. He was deeply entranced in whatever article he was reading and hadn't spoken a single word to me, even when I asked if I could join him in the last compartment with any available space. God, they're giving you a lot of exposition here. He shrugged, nodded, and adjusted his newspaper without ever making eye contact. It'd been almost an hour. In fact, he hadn't even looked... I fucked it up, man. Why am I fucking up? He hadn't once looked at me. Devoid of any conversation, I took instead to counting the buttons on the pretentiously lush carmine seat cushions. 1, 2, 3, 21, 22, and so forth over and over. Now and again, I turned to look out the window where the trees were blurring by. Sometimes, the smeared green would break and reveal the quiet blue of the Sea of Japan. Eventually, this rapidity made my stomach churn, and I went back to counting the buttons on the seat cushions. 1, 2, 3. The train compartment shuddered around us. My eyes wandered to the boy in his jacket. It wasn't the school-issued blue that I and the other students on the train were wearing. Instead, it was green, varsity-like jacket with an embroidered patch poorly sewn on the front. So you're a first year, then? He folded his newspaper neatly, set it in his lap, and looked at me with a half-interested gaze. Did he just catch me staring? Now that the paper was gone, I saw his face. He watched me through heavy-lidded eyes. His hair was immaculately groomed, his teeth straight and blindingly bright. There was something about him, the way the light hit him, that made him look like he was almost sparkling. Oh, good God, fuck this shit, man. Me? He glanced around the compartment empty beside us and laughed. Oh, no, I'm not a first year, I'm a third year. Maybe I should try getting more into character with these. The train began to slow, metal wheels groaning against the metal tracks. The sudden shift threatened to rob me of whatever was left in my stomach. But I closed my eyes and took a deep breath, willing myself to keep it together. What kind of impression would I leave puking on a student before I arrived at the academy? The boy frowned. I picked at the hem of my cotton skirt. That's not possible. I've never seen you before. It took me a moment of mouth fishing to find a response. It's because I'm a transfer student? Why is there a question mark at the end of that? Am I not sure? Oh God, am I retarded? A transfer student, huh? We don't get many of those. I removed my acceptance letter from the front pocket of my uniform. The paper, heavyweight, off-white, had accumulated creases from my reading and rereading, as if the words might have changed since the last time I read them. Oh, no, not the diary. No, how do I get out of here? Okay, there we go. Blah, 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 blah. God, he is sparkling. What the fuck is this shit? The boy took it, studied it, handed it back to me.
I'll see you around.
Well, I'll suppose I'll be seeing you around. He smiled at me as he picked up the suitcase lying next to him. By the time I hiccuped a response, he was already gone from the compartment. I stared out into the empty hallway of the train. It was then that I realized he, having gotten it from my acceptance letter, knew my name, and I never got his. Oh, the humanity. The train settled at the station and I filed out with the rest of the uniformed students. It was early April and the last frost of winter had come and gone. The trees were already green, their leaves shivering in the occasional gust weaving through them. The air was mild, only a few clouds hanging in the sky. I walked along the road with a swarm of blue-jacketed bodies, looking at the little groups breaking off from the crowd. Everyone was buzzing so animatedly around me. I held my suitcase tight in my sweaty hands. It was leather-bound and worth more than anything it contained. It wasn't far to the school, and I was, for maybe the first time in my life, thankful that what I owned didn't amount to much. My school-issued black Oxfords click, click, clicked on the pavement. I walked this walk over and over in my mind. So many nights I lay awake, imagining what it would be like to walk from the train station to Asagao Academy for the first time. My new start. I always imagined that everything would change for me on this walk, that somehow everything would be magically different. But as I looked around, I realized nothing had changed. I hadn't changed. By the time I reached the massive gates of the academy, I forgot all about the disappointments slouching in the back of my throat. Let me adjust this thing so I can get a better look. There we go. The school, framed by gates, twisted black metal, was just as beautiful as the glossy photos I saw in its pamphlets. This was it. Asagao Academy. I glanced around. The swarm of students gathered around the gate. Beyond it, tiny blue people bounced around the academy's main building. A girl pressed a button onto one side of the gate. The excitement in the air was almost palpable. A few moments later, the black gate, with great effort, creaked outwards and cleared the pathway.
Damn.
As the rest of the group shifted into motion, I followed along, a sheep in the herd. My stomach tied itself into knots. The crowd split off in different directions. For a moment, I panicked. A tired-looking man with gray hair called out for first years, a cluster of fresh-faced students gathering around him. "Hey, hey, look at that girl." I turned a few feet away. A small group of boys were pointing at me and snickering. "Pink hair? Are you kidding me?" "Yeah, that's kind of... why did you do that? Why did you give her a pink hair? Like, you know, how desperate can you get?" Hot shame crawled down my neck. I attached myself to a group of girls following a few steps behind them. In the distance, cicadas hummed in time to my shoes crunching against the gravel. My hair. It wasn't my fault that my hair looked like this. Luckily, I found myself at the girls' dormitory, a large sign in the lawn reading Primrose House. The building dwarfed me. Are you kidding? It's a building. Of course it's going to dwarf you in size. What the fuck is this shit? The building dwarfed me in size and sheer intimidation. How many students did Asagao have? As I approached the building, a red-headed girl lingering nearby caught my attention. I looked away. Then I looked back. She was staring at me. "What, bitch?" She walked over. I didn't notice at first, but they have voices, so, you know, I'm not going to narrate when they talk. I eyed her warily. She was smiling and bouncing in a way that suggested her views on life were akin to a perpetual bouncy castle.
What? Bingo.
I thought back to the paper I received a month prior with a list of all the supplies I needed for the school and my dorm arrangements. She laughed, but I couldn't figure out what was so funny. Was she laughing at me? "Bitch, I'll cut you." When I found out my roommate was a transfer student, I knew you were going to be a total main character. Oh my god, man, this thing is so self-referencing. I'm sorry, a what? Mm-hmm. When I saw you outside of the gate, I knew it was you. I mean, look at that hair. I felt a lump forming in my throat. What was she talking about? She had to be making fun of me. I hadn't spent more than 5 minutes on campus, and I was already being mocked. My hands began to tremble. Is there something wrong with my hair? Her face slackened from its amused smile to a more worried expression. Then she began laughing again.
Oh, no. It's great. I'm sorry. Getting off on the wrong foot, aren't we? Oh, gosh. I'm Mai Sasaki. You must be Hana.
I bowed my head.
Hello.
It's nice to meet you, Mai. She doesn't talk, does she, man? I'm like, every time she, Mai talks, you know, there's some accompaniment, there's some voice work done for her, but all she gets is her grunts and, like, what the fuck? All your school books are waiting in our room with your welcome letter, and I read the envelope. I hope you're not mad. She started walking towards the dorm's front doors. I followed behind, like, I clicked too quick. Did you check in at the front desk already? No, I didn't. I didn't know I was supposed to. Good, they'll offer to have a staff member give you a tour of the campus, but I can show her around. We don't get many transfer students in the year three, you know? I'm getting tired of reading this shit, man. My throat hurts already. She spoke so quickly, the words bubbling from her mouth, it left me no time to answer until the end of her monologue. Yeah, okay, that sounds good. Look how tan you got. It seemed like everyone knew each other. I followed Maya as she led me through the maze of students and up two flights of stairs. Each dorm floor looked the same as the last, narrow white doors lining both sides of the pale pink walls. Man, what the fuck is wrong with me? Thin gold numbers were tacked at the front of each, the numbers rising as we climbed. You're not missing anything with the campus tour, I promise. Mr. Saitomo does them every year and he's, like, totally dull. He just drags you around the entire campus and talks in that weird, squeaky voice of his. I'll tell you everything you need to know. I smiled, trying to let this calm my nerves. Thanks. We headed down the hallway on the third floor. Maya stopped us in front of door numbered 325. Here we are. Obsession Alvin Stein? What the fuck? A faint smell of potpourri wafted through the room. The walls, like the hallway, were a soft powdery pink. Maya all ready to face them with tapestry of posters, magazine cutouts, and photographs. Some of the photos were of cats, but most were male models and rugged musicians. Tortured souls. I can tell you right now, those guys aren't rugged. A bunk bed, two writing desks with wooden chairs, small dresser, and a mirrored vanity, all clearly provided by the school, were the only pieces of furniture in the tiny room. The top bunk was already covered by neatly tucked blankets and throw pillows of clashing patterns and colors. The bottom bunk had a single stiff-looking pillow and a thin cotton blanket that I didn't need to touch to know it was horribly itchy. I must have grimaced because Mike quickly smiled at me. I brought way too many pillows and blankets. I always overpack. I went to Italy over break and Mom got really mad at me because I bought 5 bags, but we were only there for a week. She laughed, pulled several blankets and pillows from her bunk and rearranged them neatly on mine. A sudden twinge of guilt and embarrassment hit me. That's much better. Thanks, Mai. Is she gonna do that the whole fucking time? I hate characters that are always so indecisive. I don't know what to do. I placed my suitcase on the bottom bunk and began to unpack its contents. Several changes of clothing, pens and pencils, empty notebooks, a few photographs of my father, a dilapidated stuffed rabbit, and an old portable radio and a small black box. Mai opened the curtains and the sunlight poured in. So, where are you from? I slid the now empty suitcase under the bottom bunk. About 2 hours north of here, it's a small town called Amaririsu. I must have mispronounced that, I'm sorry. Amaririsu. There we go. You probably haven't heard of it. I set the stuffed rabbit, Mr. Bunny, so creative, on my bedside on a purple and teal throw pillow. Oh. Did you go to a different boarding school or... No, I went to a public school down the street from my house. Public school? What was that like? Were the students mean? Did you have a lot of friends? I always went to private schools. My parents work a lot and my dad goes overseas, so I think they stuck me here for convenience. Oh, hey, what's that? I removed an ornately patterned origami crane from the black box and was setting it on the unclaimed writing desk. Oh, this? My mother made it for me a long time ago. I set it beside a stack of thick textbooks, which I assumed were provided for me.
Fuck, man, I must be tired or some shit.
Wow, it's so pretty. I've never seen paper like that before. Oh yeah, the lights. Let me get them. Mai went to her own desk, opened a drawer, and pulled out a long, tangled string of fairy lights. I thought these would look nice. Here, help me string them up. She grabbed a container of pushpins, pulled her wooden desk chair out and over to the one wall. I did the same with my own. Together, we pinned the lights around the perimeter of the room. How was the train ride over? Did you meet anyone? No. Not really. I was in a compartment with some guy and...
What?
Some guy, huh? Was he cute? Yeah, I guess. I don't know. I wasn't really paying attention. I didn't even get his name. Mai seemed disappointed for a moment, then perked back up. You'll have to point him out to me if you see him again. Okay. Once we finished stringing the lights, Mai climbed down from her chair and brushed her hands together triumphantly.
Yeah.
Done. Okay, now it's time for lunch. The food here is pretty good. This ramen place down the street from campus looks like out of this world, but the school only lets us leave campus on weekends. Mai walked to the window. We could go today because it's Sunday and it's pretty nice out.
Fuck, man.
I am way sleepy, apparently. We could go today because it's Sunday and it's pretty nice out, but I guess you might want to go to the cafeteria since you just got here. We could... She was suddenly interrupted by her own enthusiastic laughter. Oh my gosh, Mimi Santos totally just tripped outside and fell on her face. I saw it. Oh, does it mean to laugh? Maybe I shouldn't have. No, yeah, that's kind of fucked up. Oh well. Anyways, let's go eat. I'm totally starved. She led me outside of the room before I even had a chance to respond. The cafeteria was buzzing with students excited for the new year. The only people as nervous-looking as I felt were at the tables of skittish, wide-eyed first years. I stepped into line behind Mai, taking an empty plastic tray. We shuffled through, asking for helpings from that skulky cafeteria workers when we passed something that looked good. With full trays, Mai led me straight to the table in the back where a few students were already sitting. Maybe my brain's not getting enough oxygen. Mai sat down and I took a seat across from her. Hi, Mai. How was your break? It was good. I went to Italy and Spain. Dad fell off a ski jet and broke his ankle. Uh-huh. It's better now, though. Oh, well, that's nice. I expected to be introduced, but the girl turned back to her group of friends and Mai turned back to me. She began to assault her food with a fork and tell me in a practically minute-by-minute account about her fleeting romance last summer with a boy she met on the beach that didn't go further than a few salty kisses. I sat back and let Mai talk. For the first time since arriving on campus, I felt like I was finally able to breathe. I picked at my Brussels sprouts and studied Mai as she spoke. The more she talked, the more I began to notice small details about her. She had a high songbird voice. She was dynamic, her face twisting in this way and that into exaggerated expressions as she spoke. She laughed often. She imitated people in wildly unflattering voices, seemingly unrelated to her actual opinion of them. But most notably, she talked. A lot. I didn't find this particularly annoying as it filled the silence and she hardly ever asked questions that required my full attention. Just as Mai was rounding off a shockingly detailed account of the time she accidentally walked in on her friend's older brother in the act of changing, a flash of familiar green caught my eye. I glanced over. Hey, that's him. Huh? Who? I leaned across the table to whisper just in case he could hear me through the ambient chatter of the lunchroom. The boy from the train. That's him.
What?
Jared? Yeah, with the weird green jacket and swoopy hair. He just picked up his tray and was walking past us when something seemed to catch his eye. Hmm? Oh, you. I looked up at him, suddenly realizing he was talking to me. Hannah, I met you on the train. How are things settling down for you? Really well. I found my roommate and she's been helping me out. I gestured to Mai, who was thunderstruck. In fact, looking around, everyone was. People stopped eating to turn and stare at Jared and me. My shoulders bunched around my neck. Well, if you ever need any help, I'll be around. Third year, right? I nodded.
All right.
Some of my friends are in that year. Of course, they can't compare to me, but I'll give them the heads up to look out for you, too. He flashed a dazzling smile and winked. It's the least I can do for such a cute girl. I like this guy. Except for the sparkly. We'll see you around. Oh, well, see you around. I fucked that up. I watched, a torrent of thoughts raging through my head as he took a seat next to a bunch of guys who were all wearing the same jacket. That's Jared! I can't act. Not like this. She tore her eyes away from him and looked at me.
He's so cute!
He's the most beautiful guy in school.
Oh, Jared.
I can't believe he just looked at me. I looked at Mai. Her cheeks were glowing an indecent pink. Why do they all wear those jackets? Aren't all the guys supposed to wear blue blazers as part of the uniform? No, they're allowed to. They're... You know Jared? That girl turned back around and was looking at me with sudden interest. Did I know him? I only talked to him on the train for a few minutes, so not really. We weren't friends or anything. But looking around, Mai and this girl weren't the only ones who were interested. Everybody seemed to be listening in. They seemed so surprised when he talked to me. Maybe a little white lie couldn't hurt? Okay, this is where the dating sim part comes in. I'm normally a straight shooter. I would always be like, not really. But at the same time, this girl is starved, so I guess there's only one way to play it, which is to appeal to, you know, her desire to be popular, so I guess so. The girl looked me up and down as if she were inspecting a piece of furniture for purchase. I'm sorry, I didn't introduce myself earlier, did I? I'm Mimi. Nice to meet you. So how did you meet Jared? Oh, come off it, Mimi. Jared's not interested. Maya and Mimi stared at each other for a few seconds, having some kind of silent mental battle. Then Mimi turned away and continued to eat. Sorry, it was clear that she was just trying to get in with you for her own agenda, so I cut her off. Get in with me? Why? Well, you asked me about those guys and their jackets, right? Those are the normal Boots Club jackets. They're... what? What's normal Boots Club? Oh my god. It's a club we have at school here. It's like totally exclusive and full of only the coolest students. They get together and play video games. Or something. The one right there is John, also known as JonTron. His bird's name is Jacques. I'm coming for you, John. John is also the president of the drama club here at school. Yeah, that sounds like John. I could see him doing that. Next to him is PBG. He and John founded the... He and John founded the Normal Boots Club together. PBG is one of the best soccer players on our team. Then there's Gerard. People call him the completionist because he's obsessed with completing things. He has the biggest itty-bitty kitty collection I've ever seen. Next to him is Jared, also known as Pro Jared. He's a model. Then there's Satchbag, but everybody calls him Satch. He's like crazy smart. And those guys over there are Paul, Nick, and Josh. They write a column in the school newspaper called Continue? Paul, the one standing up, is the student council president. And the guy in the end there is Shane. He knows more about video games than anyone. Ever. She exhaled a dreamy sigh into her mashed potatoes. I think this is kind of like that whole thing where they're just fetishizing a group of guys, because you can tell that she has no interest in video games, and she's like, they play video games or something. She's just a group of hot guys, and they're just like, okay, that's hot. Kind of weird. Need a little bit of light. Oh, wrong way. So how would someone, you know, join the Normal Boots Club? You don't choose the boots, Hannah. The boots choose you. That's so cheesy. What does that even mean? You have to be presented with the boots in order to be in the club, and they're like super selective. What are the boots? The club has this boot statue. It's like one. It's like the one on their patches, but it's gold plated. It's their mascot, I guess. They do this weird initiation ritual with it. Ritual? Do I even want to join these guys? I hear they fill a room with candles and wear these totally creepy robes during initiation. This year, two girls said she saw it once and they were, like, chanting around the boots. It sounded like they were talking backwards. But I don't believe her. And even if it is true, I don't care. I don't care if they're a cult because they're all really hot. Yeah, that sounds about right. Do they have a lot of friends? Yeah, tons of friends. I'd say they're the most popular kids in school. I mean, everyone in the school totally looks up to them. I bet they could get any girl in school, too. Or boy, for that matter. Yeah, that's cool, being LGBT friendly. Hey, are you gonna eat your cake? I shook my head and pushed the plastic tray across the table to her. For the remainder of lunch, I listened to my talk about Jared through mouthfuls of half-dissolved frosting. Back at the dorm, I sorted through a pile of textbooks school left for me. My radio was playing a poppy tune, equal parts music to static. My fervently scribbled in the notebook at her desk, hunched over it with strikingly poor posture. Hey, Mai. She didn't bother to look up. Am I supposed to have a textbook for History 309? She shuffled through the papers on her desk before producing a thick textbook. A demure man in a powdered wig frowned at me from the cover. Yeah, this is the one. I sighed. I don't have that one. School must have missed it. Mai shrugged and set the textbook back in her pile. They have a bunch at the library. You can just check one out. Where's the library? Mai riffled through her notebook and wrote something down. She tore a page out and handed me a crudely drawn map. Oh, okay, well, I'll be back in a little bit. It took me at least 20 minutes to find the library. Wow, you must be an idiot. There must be signs everywhere, at least. By the time I realized I was holding the map upside down, yeah, she's an idiot. Sun was setting. The library was much larger than I expected. The library was much larger than I expected. The walls lined from floor to ceiling with books all sizes on rough wooden shelves. Intimidated, I headed to the front desk. I'm gonna fucking kill myself, man. Are you kidding me? A recognizably green and gray jacket was bent behind the counter. Normal boots. I briefly considered running away. Hey. Can I help you? Hey, it's Satch. Too late. Yeah. The school forgot to give me one of my textbooks. I was told I could get it here. Which one is it? History 309 textbook. He stepped from behind the counter and motioned for me to follow. We dodged between the aisles in a comfortable silence. He seemed friendly enough. I should say something. What was his name again? Shane? Gerard? John? No, not John.
Satch.
Satch? Huh? Oh, you work here? Of course you worked here. He chuckled, dimples appearing in his cheeks. Yeah, I'm the librarian's assistant. It's my second year and I love it. I get to help people find books that speak to them. His eyes twinkled like a kid's on Christmas. Your book's right down here. He stopped at a row of thick, dusty books. Was this all history? And pulled out the book with the powdered wigged man I saw earlier. Thanks. He waved his hand. It was nothing. Do you need help with anything else? I wanted to make a good impression for the Normal Boots Club, but I couldn't come up with anything. No. Thank you. You're welcome. As we headed back through the cavernous library, my knees melted away. We weren't talking, but just being near him felt like being wrapped in a soft blanket. I resisted the urge to snuggle up to him. We neared the front desk, stepping around a clump of studying students. As we passed, one of them shifted. Something white flew past my face. A thick piece of triangular paper lay at my feet. I bent over and picked it up. It was surprisingly heavy. There was a quarter inside of it. If it was just a hair slower, it would have hit me in the face. The student snickered, and I recognized the boys that made fun of my hair this morning among them. My heart dropped. I scanned my memory for anything I might have done to offend them, but I came up with nothing. My hand started to shake. I hid it behind my back, trying to think of some way to defend myself. Why'd you do that, Dick? What do you mean? We were just messing around. Are you suggesting we did it on purpose? I faltered. There was nothing I could say. I was outnumbered. They would twist my words around no matter how straightforward I was. Sorry. One of the boys held his hand out for the paper. I inched closer to give it to him, angry at myself for being so compliant. I wish I were. A gentle warmth closed over my hand and took the paper from me. Satch examined the paper closely. I see what the problem is. Your aim would be better if you cut the corners before you folded it. He placed the paper on the table. The boy looked at him in sheer awe. Be careful, though. You almost hit her, and that would have been awful. My hands began to sweat as panic shifted through me, afraid of the response, but... Geez, we're sorry. We'll be careful next time. Man, go fuck yourself. Why are you trying to suck up now? Yeah, it was an accident. They apologized? Thanks, I appreciate it. He gave them a wide smile and continued off down the aisles. I followed closely behind, my legs weak. Don't tell me they stopped because of him. Simply because I was with him? I wanted to thank him, but my heart was pounding so hard I knew my voice would shake. We recognized the front counter and he scanned the history book. My lips trembled as I willed myself to say something, anything to thank him. He tilted his head to the side. What books do you like to read? Fiction? I just finished a good book. I think it'd be right up your alley if you don't mind me saying so. He reached under the counter, pulled out a thick green book and passed it to me. A man in black stood at the front hugging a woman in royal robes. It's long, but it's one of my favorites, The Princess Betrothed. I know things can be tough transferring to a new school. If you're ever worried, just read this. It'll transport you 100 miles away in a second. Good advice. Always, you know, a good book will fucking help you out. Tears stung my eyes, so I ducked my head. Thank you, Satch. For more than just the books. You're welcome. Oh, I'm sorry. I don't think I got your name. Hana Mizuno. I'm a transfer student. Well, it's nice to meet you, Hana. Let me Let me know how you like the book. I will. That couldn't have gone better. Okay. Not only was Satch impossibly kind, but being around him felt easy, refreshing, like being doused in a mist of a waterfall. Oh gosh, what was I thinking? My cheeks hot, I left the library two surprisingly heavy books under one arm. How long have I been streaming already? Is there a thing right here? I settled into bed, eager to get started with my new reading material, but Mai was sitting at her desk carving a pencil idly into the pages of a notebook. Every few minutes she released a long, drawn-out sigh as the lead of her pencil whined against the paper. I lowered my book and took the bait. Is something wrong, Mai? Give me a second. I need to open a window. It's fucking hot in here. I don't know why my AC wasn't turning on, but I'm not gonna leave to go check. She let out another dreary sigh. I hope Jared notices me this year. Notice me, senpai. Does Jared know you like him? My world around in feigned shock.
What?
I don't like Jared. I closed my book and set it aside, deciding to play along. Have you at least tried talking to him? No. I mean, I have before. Why don't you try again? She bobbed her head from side to side, considering this like it never crossed her mind before. Yeah, maybe I could do that. Satisfied, I picked my book back up. Have you ever had a boyfriend, Hana?
What?
No. I could tell just by the reaction what was coming. I'll bet you 10,000 yen that you meet a totally cute boy here and fall in love by the end of the school year. You're crazy. I buried my face back in my book, barring Mai from any further discussion. Fall in love by the end of the year? Me? If I were a betting kind of girl, I'd take that bet. I awoke the next morning with what felt like a lizard in my throat. Me too, man. I'm tired of narrating this shit, but I don't want to just, you know, it'd be boring if I don't fucking say something. Mai was already up shuffling through her school bag with an enigmatic grin. The first day of school. You're finally awake. Her voice sliced through the air like a knife and I winced. She was definitely a morning person. It's time for the first day of school, aren't you excited? No. I can't wait to see what's gonna happen. What do you mean? Is something special happening today? Something strange always happens on the first day of school, especially to someone like you. Oh my god. She winked. Yeah, main character. She smiled and started messing with a pile of papers on her desk. Shaking my head, I got out of bed and pulled my uniform out of my closet. My palms sweat as I held the gold vest and blue jacket. Was it really possible for things to be different here than they were at home? What if the problem wasn't actually the school? I shook the thoughts out of my head and changed into my uniform. Oh. What is it? You look so cute.
Really?
Heat crept up in my neck.
Yeah.
Completely, your hair matches your uniform so well. You look like a flower blooming straight out of the ground. Thanks. Water stung the back of my eyes, and I turned to start packing my backpack. Why was I getting worked out about something as little as this? I must have gotten less sleep than I thought. Is something wrong? No, nothing's wrong. I'm just happy. How dumb was that? I started crying at the first sign of someone being nice to me. I took a deep breath to steady my nerves. What an oddly menacing thud. All the air left my lungs as something like a horse hooves slammed against my back. You'll do just fine, don't worry, this is gonna be awesome. I stiffly peered over my shoulder. That was you?
What?
Mai stood behind me, her hand raised. Somehow she had the strength of a bodybuilder. Nothing. I was just about to zip my bag up when I spotted the book Satch gave me lying on my nightstand. The Princess Betrothed. He said that if I ever needed to be transported somewhere far away, I could take it with me. It was pretty good so far. Maybe it would be smart to bring it along, just in case I had no one to talk to between class periods. Would I need it for my first day of class? I'm gonna take it. But before I take it, I'm gonna adjust my camera. I think it's like a little awkward to just be looking at the side of my face, my profile. So I went ahead and did that. So take the book with me. I put my already overfull bag, biting my lip. Never hurt to be prepared, right? You ready?
Yeah.
Stick with me and you'll be fine. Mai opened the door and together we stepped out into the hallway, merging into a steady flow of chittering girls and fruit-flavored perfume. Oh my, I'm not gonna read that shit. I did not know we lived on the same floor. No way, really? That's awesome. Now we'll be able to catch up. Whatever happened between you and... The river of girls shifted as we headed down the first, down the stairs. I suddenly found myself surrounded by a bunch of people I did not know. Oh wow, what a jerk he turned out to be. Mai's exclamations faded into the buzz of voices in the air. Oh no. What would I do if we got separated? Anxiously, I searched the crowd of girls for Mai, but I couldn't find her. Everyone was dressed in the same Asagao uniform. It was difficult to tell anyone apart, and being so short really didn't help the situation. As we turned the last corner down the stairwell, I saw a flash of red hair a little ways in front of me. Mai? I reached between the two girls and tapped her on the shoulder. Huh? Oh, Who are you? The girl's eyes flashed, almost like a jolt of electricity shot through them. I'm sorry, I thought you were someone else. She said nothing and turned away before I knew it. I stood outside of the Primrose House watching the flow of girls disperse across campus. Mai was nowhere to be seen. I couldn't even hear her chirpy voice. Oh, man. I took a deep breath, biting my lip. This wasn't a big deal. I could go to class alone. I didn't even know where the building was. I reached into my backpack and dragged out my class schedule. Homeroom. 206 Poppy Hall. Which one was Poppy Hall again? Weren't the classrooms on the other side of campus? I picked a direction and began walking, trying to ignore my rising panic at the thought of arriving late to the first day of class. As a third year where no one knew me, all of the people staring. Hey, you okay? You look a little lost. I recognized that voice anywhere. Fucking JonTron. Someone called out to me and I turned around, almost jumping for joy. When I froze. Another normal boots jacket? He was part of the normal boots club. I could practically feel my tongue swelling in my mouth. If this was normal boots club member, I had to make a good impression. He was one of the founders, right? Then he must be JonTron. Yes. I'm new. I don't know where Poppy Hall is. You're a freshman? No problem. Mai class is in Poppy Hall. I'll walk you there.
Really?
That would be wonderful. Thank you. Was this really happening? He began walking towards a large brick building in an enthusiastic manner, pumping his arms up and down like he was in some kind of show tune. I fell into step beside him. That sounds like JonTron. Oh yeah, I don't know if you guys know. Probably not, but the whole reason that I'm like obsessed with JonTron, it's a joke, obviously. But he's the only guy that I watch. I don't watch anybody else in the Normal Boots Club, like on YouTube. I'm subscribed to JonTron, love his videos, think he's hilarious. The other guys, I don't fucking know who they are. I think I watched Peanut Butter Gamer before, wasn't into it. I know of The Completionist. I don't know him, like, I don't watch his videos, but I know of him. And that's about it. So, JonTron's the only guy that I watch, and I'm a fan of his and all that, so yeah. So yeah, JonTron. I'm coming for that ass. Okay, I gotta tune that back. He began walking towards oh, I already read that. I didn't notice when Mai pointed him out to me yesterday, but JonTron had a big brown eyes and a warm-looking face. He was basically a human puppy. Yeah, that sounds like JonTron. I glanced up at him out of the corner of my eye. A bird. A bird on his shoulder. Birds always made me uncomfortable, something about the ease in which they could poke out someone's eyes. Something wrong? Why'd you stop? No, nothing's wrong. He followed my gaze to the bird on his shoulder.
Hey.
Oh, this is Jacques. Isn't he cute? Nice to meet you. Oh, why didn't they get the bird voice? You could easily get a robot voice. Come on. It spoke? Yeah. He put his hand on his shoulder. Jacques jumped into his palm. Jacques is a robot bird. See? Oh my god, they're keeping in... Hello? Jacques' eyes gleamed a dangerous red when he spoke, but nothing else suggested he wasn't a normal bird. In fact, if I had known any better, I would say the red in his eye was painted on. That was amazing. Jacques twisted his head to the side, examining me in return. The more he looked at me, the less afraid I was. What are you looking at?
What?
Nothing, I'm sorry. Oh yeah, Jacques can be a little sassy. Or like a little assy, but... Who are you calling sassy? I'm not the sassy one. I don't forget to feed you. Jacques, that was one time. I was all alone and starving in the frozen tundra of this empty world. Loveless. Afraid. Ignore him. I've been bringing him with me to the drama club, and he's taken a little too well to it. I see how this is. Shut me out like I have nothing to add to the conversation. Jacques retook his place on Jean's shoulder, this time facing away from us, as if miffed. We resumed our walk towards Poppy Hall. I'm JonTron, by the way. Call me John. Hana, nice to meet you. Hana, that's a cute name. Thank you. So how long have you had Jacques? Since middle school. We've been together for 4 years now. Ain't that right? I'm not listening. Yeah, well, I love him to death, so I don't know what I'd do without him. It seemed like life would be a lot easier without him, but who was I to say? We arrived at the brick building, a white sign surrounded by poppies declared it to be, unsurprisingly, Poppy Hall. Which room are you in?
Room 206.
Really?
Seriously? Yes. That's my homeroom. We're in the same class. John laughed and clasped me on the shoulder. Wonderful. I guess I'll be seeing more of you then, right?
Right.
Together we entered Poppy Hall. I'm actually going to go get some water because I've been reading and my throat fucking hurts, so give me a sec, you guys. Together we entered Poppy Hall. Poppy Hall was lined with fluorescent lights and Asagao blue lockers. The lack of students milling around in the hallway indicated that we were a bit late. We ran up the stairs and made it into the classroom just as the bell rang. My heart caught in my throat. Thankfully, the teacher hadn't come yet. Instead, students clumped into tight pods and milled about the classroom, catching up on vacation news. Thank you so much for showing me to class, John.
See you later.
No problem, I'll see you around. Well, they're in the same class. Where the fuck is he going? He waved and disappeared into the wriggling mass of students. I glanced around the room, looking for an empty seat.
Hana!
Hana. Mai peeled herself from between me and a cuddling couple. Was that JonTron? Were you just talking to JonTron? Fuck yeah, I was talking to JonTron. Yeah. Mai's eyes widened and I couldn't help feeling a little smug. I realized I didn't know the way to class after you and I got separated and he offered to walk me. Yeah, she looked smug. Mai emitted a highly pressurized squeal. JonTron walked you to class? Oh my gosh, you have to tell me everything. She grabbed me by the wrist and pulled me into an empty desk in the back corner of the room right next to the window. Oh yeah, the main character always sits by the window. I saved you a seat. I slid in and took off my backpack, hooking it on the side of my desk. I was a little bit worried that the books inside were too heavy for the bag to handle, but so far it held up well. Sorry we got separated, by the way. It can get a little chaotic sometimes. So tell me, what happened? What did he say? What did he smell like? Does he have peach fuzz? Is it rough? Wait, what? These are very important questions I'm asking. You need to answer them. Was his hair super silky, or did it have a roughness to it like a dog's coat? I fucked that last line up, but who cares? Before I could answer, the door to the front of the room slid open and a tall woman strolled in. The class went quiet and obediently slid into their seats. My heart beat furiously, blood rushing through my ears. Miss Shizuka. Good morning, class. The teacher's melodious voice swam through the room, calming the buzzing high of the students back from break. My shoulders relaxed and my fear ebbed away. I am your teacher, Shizuka Wakahisa. You may call me Miss Shizuka. The emphasis she placed on the word led me to believe calling her Mrs. wasn't a mistake she would take lightly. Some of you might have noticed that we have a new student in this semester. A hail of murmurs passed through the class. Some people glanced at me. Nope. There was the fear again. Would you like to come up and introduce yourself? I nodded, stood, and slowly walked to the front of the room, counting my steps to make sure I wouldn't fall. I faced the class, took a deep breath, and introduced myself. I noticed a familiar face in the crowd. There was John, sitting with two other boys wearing normal boots club jackets. Some of the boys, the tallest one, was staring at me, the barest of frowns on his face. Something about him seemed really familiar. Wait, he was PBG, wasn't he? The other founder of the normal boots club. Suddenly, all of the strength left my knees. What should I do? Why was he frowning? Was it possible that I already made a bad impression of him? You had to be kidding me. If he didn't like me, what did it mean about everybody else? Wouldn't they follow his lead? I swallowed. The faces of the class began to congeal, forming one giant blob. You moved from Amaririsu, right? I nodded and swallowed again. Then, like a beacon of light, I noticed Mai smiling and giving me a thumbs up. That's right. What would Mai do in this situation? Yes. I've just... Okay, she's gonna talk. I bowed my head to the class and they clapped politely. When I looked up, PBG wasn't frowning, but he still seemed oddly confused. Maybe he always looked like that. Thank you. You may be seated. I returned to my seat, heaving a small sigh. The hardest part of the day was over. Shizuka began to talk about our standard procedure for the semester, the rules for classes, when homework was due, and that sort of thing. It was all very familiar to my old school, and I spaced out in spite of myself. A brief flicker of movement caught my eye. PBG again. I glanced at him, and his head snapped back to the blackboard. What was his problem? Class continued on like that until finally the bell rang and it was time for lunch. Mai stretched her arms over her head and yawned. Man, I hate the first day of class. It's always so boring. Weren't you looking forward to it this morning? Something about exciting things happening? Well, yeah, but it already did. You met JonTron, didn't you? Now I've got nothing left to look forward to. She sighed. And I was hoping to see Jared before class, too. She slouched and fell across the front of my desk. It seemed like this would be happening a lot. Is Jared really that hot? Blasphemy. Mai's head snapped back up, her eyes flashing. What did you say? If you stare directly at him for too long, your nose will melt off. I've seen it happen.
That is the most ridiculous fucking thing ever.
Anyways, let's head to lunch. I'm super hungry. Okay, she was just fucking with her. I looked at my backpack. It held up well throughout class, but I worried that if I didn't take some of my stuff out now, I might do some permanent damage to it. Especially with Satch's books in there. I couldn't exactly afford a new backpack. I need to put something in my locker first. But if we don't go now, they'll run out of sesame seed buns. That's okay. I'll just go on ahead. Come find me, okay? Alright. I was so lucky to have someone like her as my roommate. She's gonna betray you. I guarantee it. Quick as I could, I went to my locker and shoved the book inside. As good as a book was, I was infinitely happier that I had Mai around so I didn't have to read it. Without her, who knew what I would do with myself? Oh, maybe that's where I fucked up. Maybe I should have left the book behind and then this wouldn't happen. I wouldn't have had to be separated from her. I'm probably going to meet Peanut Butter Gamer this way, though. Without her, who knew what I would do with myself, especially with PBG staring at me like that. Maybe I could go ask her what was up with him when I met her at the cafeteria. It might just be the way he was. Cheered, I headed to the cafeteria. I carried my melon bread through the minefield of people searching for the now familiar sight of Maya's hair. Where is she? I couldn't see her anywhere, and there were almost no empty seats. All around me, students circled each other, laughing, joking, sharing bites of food, and splitting the cost for sodas. Suddenly, I felt very obvious and very alone. Isn't there anywhere I can sit? Just then, I spotted a table at the front of the room. A lone boy sat at it, stabbing at his spaghetti with the vigor of a Roman general. He was having a hard time with it. I moved closer to him, working up the courage to go sit with him. Well, no wonder he was eating his spaghetti with a spoon. Wait a second. This guy was in my class, wasn't he? I saw him that morning in the front of the room. And he was wearing a jacket just like the normal Boots Clubs, but different. A gold and gray jacket with an 8-bit block on the front. Was he a member of another club, or maybe he was friends with them?
Hey.
Oh, my. Maya appeared between me and the boy who glanced up at us before returning to his spaghetti. Thank goodness I found you. I saved a table for you in the back. Oh. I looked at the boy in the back at Mai. Come on. Another backstory? She grabbed my shoulder rather forcefully and pushed me to the back of the room. Hey, what's wrong?
Wow.
You are so lucky I got there when I did. That kid is Brutal Moose. His real name's Ian. He's from the Hidden Block Club. The Hidden Block Club? Oh god, is there gonna be a gang rivalry? Yeah, they're the rival. Yes, of the... He's really weird. I mean, she looked around her to make sure no one was listening, but they were completely alone, but we were completely alone in our little corner of the cafeteria. He speaks in Comic Sans, what the fuck? Whoa. Yeah, it'd be better to stay away from him. Especially since you've already gotten to know some of the Normal Boots guys. What are you talking about? I only just met John today.
Haha,
yeah, right. I saw the way PBG was staring at you. He totally likes you.
Really?
Is that what you thought it was? Ugh. Either Mai was blind or she had a serious case of wishful thinking. Oh, totally. It was so cute. Just like my favorite manga. You meet in high school, fall in love, then go off and fight aliens together. I don't think that's gonna happen. Have some faith in yourself. That's totally what's happening. So now that you're in good with PBG, can you introduce me to Jared? Oh, was that what she was getting at? A hot flash of doubt seized me. Was it possible that Mai only liked me because she thought I knew the Normal Boots guys? That couldn't be the case, though. She was so nice. Still, looking at her shining and eager face, I couldn't talk myself out of the idea. I actually thought PBG didn't like me.
What?
Why would you think that?
Well...
He was glaring at me. Man, you just don't understand. It's a love triangle. A love triangle. With who? I can see it. Stars practically erupted from her eyes. PBG, I can't. But Hana, I love you.
PBG.
Oh my god, this is getting real. Shit. My maidenhood. Where are you going with this? I slammed my fork onto the table. Mai looked pleased with herself. Okay, I'm just kidding. You're really cute when you blush. You almost match your hair. That's not fair at all. I beg to differ. Still. I'm getting real tired of narrating this shit. You guys just fucking read. Oh, but if I click too fast, then... Ah, fuck. That was an impressive scenario.
What?
No, I wasn't. I just made it up on the spot. Mai laughed nervously. Oh, so that was the girl who was talking to me when we got separated. Mai told the story of her past friendship with this girl like they were eternal arch-nemeses. Apparently, they had some bad blood. I nodded, choosing to take the time to relax. Before I knew it, we were finished eating. We got up and tossed our trays together as I headed towards the door. As I headed towards the door, though, Mai hesitated. Hey, I forgot something back at the dorm. Oh, need help? Oh, no, I'm totally okay. I'm just going to go get it. I'll see you later, though, right?
See you later.
Okay. I waved and Mai sprinted off in the direction of the dorms. Alone again, I crossed my arms and headed back to Poppy Hall. Large groups of 7 or 8 people were laying out in the sun, playing catch and eating lunch on the lawn. Why are there no animations, man? They don't have to move. Just put them there. Set the scene. It looked like fun to have so many friends like that. I smiled. Maybe this new school really would be better than my last. Without students inside of it, Poppy Hall looked a bit like an abandoned hospital. My footsteps echoed as I climbed the stairs to the 4th floor. With a sigh, I opened up my locker and pulled out the book Satch gave me. It was a good thing I brought it after all. My boy sat on the windowsill and he jerked up when I came in. He was silhouetted by the afternoon sunshine and I couldn't quite tell who he was. Hello, I'm sorry, did I bother you? The boy stood and shook his head and crossed to a desk on the opposite side of the room. It's Gerard, not Jared. Is it Gerard? Fuck. Who gives a fuck? We're gonna find out right now. As I passed, I was able to see him clearly. Another normal boots jacket? This guy. Oh, Shane. Fuck. How on earth did this keep happening to me? Well, you're the fucking protagonist. Get used to it. Shane sat down at his desk and fidgeted with his hands a little, then turned to look at me. You're the new girl. I nodded. My name is Hannah. It's nice to meet you. He nodded. Shane. Silence filled the space between us. Panic built up inside of me. This was my chance to get in with the Normal Boots Club, and I was blowing it. I walked to my desk and sat down, setting the book on top of it. Shane looked at me, unsmiling. You're part of the Normal Boots Club. Like, that's not obvious. Yes, I am. Why? He spoke as if it were a challenge, almost glaring at me. Oh, I just saw your jacket, so I trailed off. The jackets are really cool.
Okay.
Yes, they are. Silence again. He seemed skeptical, as if he expected me to crawl out of my skin and reveal myself to be a large amphibious reptile. That was very descriptive. I had to do something. Who knew when I had another chance like this? Who knew when another chance like this would come? But Shane didn't seem friendly. In fact, he seemed downright suspicious. Surely he wasn't on to me already. Maybe it was better not to risk it. Let's see. What do I want to do? What should I do? Hold on, let me check my Twitch. I haven't checked to see if anybody was even watching me. Who knows? Maybe you guys are commenting. Okay, let's find out. Although maybe this is a bad idea because I don't want to, like, you know, slow down my connection so much. I just need to see the fucking comments, if there's any. Probably none, but who gives a fuck? Yeah, nobody's watching me. That was retarded. Okay, in that case, I think I'm going to try talking to him. So you play games then? Shane looked over at me. I've always been interested in video games, but I didn't get to play them much growing up. They're really expensive and my dad couldn't afford them, but I used to go over to my friend's house to play there. Shane didn't respond. Now what? I was out of stuff to say. What did you play? Mario Kart? We'd get into battle mode on the triple deck. He would drive around by himself on the top level, and I'd try to booby-trap the lowest level. There's a good spot next to the ramp. I'd wait there until my mom came racing down the ramp to find me, and then I'd smash her with a red shell. Shane's angry stare faded. He was smiling. Good, I'm getting in good. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and exit Twitch. Alright, Shane's angry stare faded. He was smiling, sort of. He made the whole room seem ten shades brighter, or maybe I was more relaxed. Your mom must have been mad. She was, but she always let me do it, probably on purpose. Did your mom... A door slid open. Mimi and her friends and a couple of chattering girls entered the classroom. They stopped and stared at for me and to Shane. It was clear they thought they were interrupting something, but even though we were sitting on opposite ends of the room, Yeah. Man. Sorry. No, it's fine. I'd be lying if I said I wasn't happy they caught me talking to the Shane of the Normal Boots Club. The girls went to their desks and sat down. What were you... Shane was staring at me again, an odd, hurt look on his face. I immediately felt like I was caught doing something I wasn't supposed to do. Did he know what I was trying to do? But I mean, it wasn't like I didn't want to talk to him. He was an interesting guy. It's not like I only talked to him because he was in normal boots. But he turned, pulled his nose out, pulled out a notebook and some pens and scribbled away, thoroughly ignoring me. The air was stuffy. I tugged at the collar of my shirt, sweating. The girls kept looking over at looking at me over their shoulders as if they were expecting something. I smiled hesitantly at them. They smiled back, then started a conversation amongst themselves. The atmosphere was broken. I heaved a sigh of relief. What was up with these normal boots guys? John was really nice when I spoke to him, but PBG and Shane seemed to hate me. They were anything but normal. I waited for Mai to come to class, wanting desperately to tell her what happened. But when the bell rang, Miss Shizuka started teaching, and Mai still hadn't come. Ooh, what's going on with Mai? Class came and went. Bell rang and I was alone. PBG stared at me for the entirety of the class period, his face growing more and more menacing by the minute. How his face wasn't stuck in a permafrown, I would never know. Shane and John didn't bother talking to me as they left the classroom, and the other students paired up around me. Hey Mimi, would you like to engage in casual discourse this evening? Yeah, of course. But why are you talking like that? I stuffed my book into my backpack and headed to the dorm. With a sigh, I unlocked the door to my room. As soon as the door opened, I heard, Hana! And Mai and I lay in a heap on the floor. I'm so glad you're back. She wrapped her arms around my head and nuzzled me. What are you doing? Come look, look! She got off me and helped me to my feet. Without Mai's face filling my vision, I saw something that had changed. Oh my goodness! The dorm room looked nothing like it had before. The posters and fairy lights were still up, but now the window had light pink curtains on it that cast a warm haze around the room. A brand new white carpet was on the floor, pillows piled high in a mountain on the top bunk of the bunk bed. Even our chairs had been replaced with new cushy leather ones. Why the fuck are you lying? Like, there's fucking right there, there's still a white chair. What happened here? Sorry I didn't tell you, but I wanted to surprise you. I thought this would come in yesterday, but I was delayed by a day. I wanted to set it up to be a big surprise. I'm still not done yet, though. She gestured to some small potted plants arranged in neat rows on her desk. Wanna help?
Yeah.
Do I ever? We finished setting the room up, switching a few objects here and there in order to better facilitate the feng shui, which Mai told me was excruciatingly important. She especially wanted to make sure our room was filled with reds and pinks and coupled items, though for what purpose, I wasn't sure. We collapsed with heavy sighs on the floor and then heaved great big yawns. It's not even the end of the day yet, and I'm so tired. Damn, man, this thing's kind of bugging my ears. Me too. Wait! She shot up suddenly with a jolt. We should get some ice cream. Ice cream, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, something to celebrate being roommates. The ice cream here on campus is genuinely good, I promise.
I don't know.
And I'm paying. Well, if that's the case, you made an offer I can't refuse. Sweet, let's go. The school shop was in a side building off the cafeteria, packed with instant noodles and giant bottles of soda. Students wandered into the aisles, aimlessly. Clearly, here more to spend time than money. I feel like a retard. Mai paid the cashier and we grabbed our ice cream cones. Mine the one covered in sprinkles. Whoa, this is delicious.
Yeah.
Isn't it? We're lucky to have such good food on campus. This place would be awful if we didn't. I nodded, and I was about to respond when I noticed a commotion outside. Ooh, let's see what's going on. Mai grabbed my arm, dragged me outside. There, three boys who were wearing normal boots jackets were shouting at each other, each of their faces turning purple. this again.
What?
Mamma mia!
I'm clearly the only one who possesses the proper masculine form. Yeah, I'm taller than you and more attractive to boot. Come on, guys. Can you not see these muscles? Nick pulled back the sleeves of his jacket and flexed his arm. Okay, so they're jocks. These guys always go on about weird stuff like this. They're very energetic. Oh, yeah? Josh got into the downward-facing dog yoga pose and grinned. Look at this butt. Just look at this. Okay, that's funny. What I don't understand is why don't they just ask Jared? Oh, yeah? Paul kneeled low to the ground, then took off in a sprint, heading straight for us.
Yeah!
Check this out. He sprang into the air, graceful ballerina's leap, spinning through the sky, and finally came straight for me. Ouch. When I opened my eyes, I was sprawled flat on the ground, covered in dirt. How did he not see her? Something cold and wet oozed onto the top of my blouse. Hannah, are you okay? Chunks of ice cream fell from my blouse to my skirt. Ugh. What happened? You just ran into someone, you idiot. My uniform. It's ruined. For a few seconds, silence and snickers rippled around me like the whining of cicadas. My throat closed up, water stinging my eyes. Not this again. I stood up prepared to walk out with dignity when the entirety of the normal boots club suddenly appeared in the front of my face. What happened here? Seriously? Tears slid down my face. No, not here. I didn't want to cry in front of them.
Hey.
Hannah, are you alright? I'm going home. It's fine. I just want to be alone for now. This is kind of dramatic. Like, if he fucking attacked her, like, out of like spite, then I could get it, but she just, you know, he was being an idiot and just, an accident. I'd be pissed, not fucking crying. I immediately changed into my pajamas and climbed into bed, reaching for my stuffed rabbit. What am I gonna do if this ends up like last time? Mr. Bunny stared at me with his big lifeless eyes. I squished him to my chest, losing myself in his soft fur. The door opened with a soft click. Are you okay? Finally, she sat down at her desk and began to work on something. The sound of her pencil scratching against the papers stilled my mind. I don't know how many hours passed, but eventually I fell asleep. I woke up to my alarm beeping, feeling the dread of the hours to come. After the nightmare that was the ice cream incident yesterday, I never wanted to take another step out of my room. I curled up inside my blankets, as my alarm went off. It was only the second day of school, and I felt the same as I did every morning at home. Maya, of course, was already up, and I could hear her hair straightener clap shut every few seconds from across the room. I felt bad about letting the alarm go off for so long, so I slid my hand out of the covers to switch it off. Hannah? Hannah, get up, sleepyhead. I know you're awake. I didn't have time to poke my head out of before my body slammed into the edge of my mattress, bouncing me up. She jumped from almost halfway across the room. You can't hide from me, Mai. Sorry. I mean, Hannah. I was breathless, and I paused to calm my heart before speaking again. Are you worried about what happened yesterday? No one cares about it, Hannah. I almost forgot about it myself. She must have seen my face. She brought an arm around my shoulders and pulled me closer to her. For real, though, we're gonna go to class, and no one's even gonna mention that you made a huge fool of yourself yesterday. You could have put that better. She really could have. I'm kidding. It might have been a big scene, but it totally wasn't your fault. It was Paul, all right? When you jump, you have to calculate your trajectory like I did just now. You could have learned a lot from a master like me. Get dressed and cheer up. I could bottle your gloom and sell it to a wizard. And what if he used it for evil? You can't let that happen, Hannah. Her smile was wide enough to bridge the gap between continents. The beginnings of tears prickled at the back of my eyes, but this time they were for a different reason. I opened my closet and tried to avoid looking at the sad lump of clothing inside, slathered with dried up ice cream. I had only two uniforms, which cost my dad an entire month's salary. How expensive is this fucking place? If I wasn't able to get the stain out of this uniform, what would I do? Sighing, I took my second uniform off its hanger and slipped it on as my waiting impatiently for me. Ready to go? I guess so.
Yeah!
Good. I think I want to end it already. Okay, the next time I have an option pop up, I'm gonna end it. Like, I'll make the decision and it'll be over. Just as Mai said, no one paid any attention to me. Well, there was a few odd looks here and there, but nothing nearly as bad as what I was expecting. As the lecture went on, my anxiety, for the most part, faded. I took to staring out the window to avoid eye contact. A few boys were out in the field playing soccer. Wait, was that PBG? I scooted closer, trying to get a better look. Hana? At the sign of my name, I leapt to attention. If there's something more interesting outside than samurai death battles, please feel free to enlighten us. You came here to learn, not contemplate the scenery. Yes, Miss Shizuka, I'm sorry. She turned back to the chalkboard and continued to lecture as if nothing happened. A few desks in front of me, a guy sitting next to Brutal Moose turned around and gave me the flashy thumbs up. I made a face at him, unsure exactly of what he expected me to do. Then Ian turned around and socked him in the head. What the fuck? The other guy mumbled something to him, probably apologizing. Ian's eyes slid to me for a brief instant. Then he looked away. Were they looking at me because of what happened yesterday, or was there some other reason? I shook my head. There wasn't time for this. I had work to do if I wanted to keep my scholarship. After pages and pages of notes on Japanese history, it was nearly time for lunch. Okay, everyone is almost free to go. The work for tonight isn't so hard, so don't grumble. You should work together to complete it if you have a hard time. Also, as you may be aware, the flower festival is coming up in a week and a half. This news was met with a few cheers as everyone started to pack up. Since you have the day of the festival off, our first exam will be the day before. There was no cheers this time. Romance is wonderful, believe me, I know, but try not to let the festival distract you, okay? That is all. See you tomorrow. Miss Shizuka flashed a peace sign and winked as she walked out the door. What a weird teacher. Ugh, that lecture was so boring. Mai walked beside me, a tray in her hands. We were shuffling through the cafeteria trying to find a seat. Didn't you say that yesterday? And probably, but it's true for today too. Help me. I'm gonna die of boredom. We have an assignment to keep us busy, Mai.
What?
You already have work to do? How did you not hear that? Mai sighed dramatically, then leaned to the side and rested her head on the crook of my neck. I reached up to pat her head a few times, but she straightened out before I could do it. Oh god, Hana, Paul's walking over here. He's looking at you. Does he look angry to you? Why is he coming over here? Do you think he's going to kick you again? The same Paul who humiliated me last night strode towards me. I instinctively backed away, but he kept coming closer. I'm glad I found you. He didn't look angry at me. In fact, he was giving me an odd lopsided smile. I wanted to make sure you weren't hurt or anything. You ran off before I could properly apologize. I looked down at my feet. It was embarrassing enough that I ran off crying like a little girl, but to know that I made him feel bad was even worse. At the same time, the image of my ruined uniform popped to my mind. I couldn't tell whether I was more angry or embarrassed, or whether I was feeling something else entirely. I got you pretty bad, didn't I? I think a ballerina'd too hard. That is so stupid. He tilted his head to the side. It's a shame you're not wearing that uniform from yesterday. I like the pink splotches on you. It matched your hair. A deep, sick feeling crawled up from my stomach to sit in my throat. My dumb, stupid hair. Everywhere I went, people made fun of it. I thought that normal boots guys were different, and he was trying to apologize. How could he say something like that to me? Not for the first time, I thought of dyeing it a different color, but I quickly dismissed it. Paul was waiting for a response, giving me a quick nod as if warning me not to mess this up. I mustered up my best smile, hoping that it was at least somewhat convincing. It's okay. I'm fine. Don't worry about it. Anyway, I'm more than happy to pay for the dry cleaning. Josh and Nick and I feel really bad about everything. We've never made a girl cry before. Well, not physically injuring her. Not by physically injuring her, I guess. Thank you, but I was just going to scrub it in the sink. Dad and I could never afford things like dry cleaners, so I was surprisingly good at hand washing things. That thing's going to need more than hot water and soap, trust me. Tell you what. I have a friend who's a natural with that kind of stuff. I'll ask her to get the stain out for you. Just meet me later and bring your uniform, okay? I'll try not to kick you this time. Without giving me time to say yes or no, he nodded and turned to leave. He spun quickly back around. I flinched. Are you and Mai, right? Do you guys have a table? The cafeteria is pretty full right now. You can sit with us if you want, just for today. Yes, we'll go right now. Right, Hana? Oh my god. She's so thirsty. Lunch with the Normal Boot Club? Maybe. Maybe I really could become friends with them, and then no one would bother me again. Not about my hair or the ice cream incident. Right?
Yeah.
All right.
Hey, you found her. You're Hana, right? I nodded, blushing as I took a seat at the edge of the table next to Paul. Mai forced herself between Jared and PBG. Her eyes were only a few sparkles away from forming huge hearts. Real subtle. So Hana, we saw that you were upset and we were all worried. Are you feeling better? PBG looked at me, clearly concerned. My heart was beating hard against my chest, but I wasn't sure whether it was because I was nervous or because the sad look on his face made me want to give him a hug. Or maybe it was because I was about 2 inches away from Paul and only an arm's length away from all the other guys. As I tried valiantly to open my mouth, whispers sped about the lunchroom. Look at those girls over there. Who do they think they are? How come they get to sit there? I wish Senpai would notice me. Sporty girl. Main characters get all the luck. Suddenly my thoughts turned dark. Could it be that by getting close to these guys I was setting myself up as a target instead of getting protection? My thoughts spun in my head. It was suffocating. PBG was still looking at me, even more worried than before. I'm fine. Thanks for your concern. Please don't feel bad. It was my fault for getting in the way. I'm sorry for causing such a scene. I should have controlled myself better. I hung my head. I wasn't sure about how to act with these guys, so I defaulted to being extremely polite. My father would have been proud. Hey, Hana, don't apologize. It was Paul's fault. Right, Polly? Nick shoved Paul, who looked exasperated. I apologized as best I could, Nick. Give me a break. It was a relief that PBG wasn't staring at me anymore. Almost no one else was paying me or Mai any attention. Shane, however, was still shooting me quick, suspicious glances. It was almost like he didn't want me there, and I felt uncomfortable.
Hey, Hana.
How do you like it here so far, Hana? Good, how about you? I mean, I like it here, thank you. Gerard smiled at me, then turned away. I picked up my food. The guys were all wrapped up in their own conversations, and Mai was busy preventing hyperventilation from being so close to Jared. I can feel his body heat. Oh dear.
Hey.
You doing okay, Hana? A smiling Satch turned to me. You know we can be overwhelming. You're fine, right?
Yeah.
I know we can be overwhelming, my bad. Thank you. Thanks for recommending me that book, by the way. It's been really good. Do you like it? That's great. I figured you would. It's really funny, but the narrator's annoying. Is that a shot at me? You can go fuck yourself, Mai. Or Hana. Yeah, he can be a bit rude. He pushed up his glasses, then grinned at me. You were pretty quiet, but I knew there was more to you. I winced. Sorry, I can be a bit of a wallflower. No need to apologize. I'm sure we've all been wallflowers before. But that reminds me, the flower festival. He turned to the group, addressing them all, and as if on cue, they all suddenly turned to pay him attention. Who are you all taking this year? Right, the flower festival. Mishizuka mentioned it before. What is the flower festival? No one's explained it to me yet. It's basically just a festival. Don't you have those at your old school? We did have festivals at my old school, but they were basically just 40 kids grouped in one room sharing snacks they brought from home. Well, we had something kind of like them, but I stopped going.
Really?
Oh, really? Why? They're so fun. I didn't really want to answer. There was no way I could say, well, my friends turned on me, so when I went, people pretended I didn't exist. That's fucking harsh. Is that what happened? Jesus. No wonder she's got fucking issues. But Mai was waiting for an answer, and everyone was looking at me. I'm just not into that stuff, I guess. Oh well, maybe you'd like this one more. The flower festival happens all over Japan. The flower festival happens all over Japan around this time of year, but it's a big deal in Higanbana. Higanbana? Really? Usually it's like Higabana or something like that. That's the one in town next to Asagao. There's apparently some kind of myth about flowers that's somewhat important. Supposedly, the founder of Higanbana was an old man who got lost in the mountains and almost died of thirst. The flower spirit came to him and offered him help in return for his vow to protect her home. He agreed, and she drained herself of all her water so he could drink, and the man founded Higanbana to watch over the meadow in which he met the flower. In some versions of the myth, the man and the flower spirit fell in love. It's truly a romantic festival. One may hope to find someone with which to make a vow of eternal love, just as man and the spirit did, and to live on to protect the one they love. For some reason, I keep stuttering over this shit. Jared winked, and Mai swooned. So during the day of the flower festival, there's a lot of stalls set up, and you can go play games and eat food or go flower viewing. Then at night, there's a special meadow over by the temple where you can go watch the flowers, and there's a bonfire and dancing. It's a lot of fun. We look forward to it every year. Asagao sells paper flowers in a little booth to raise money for the school, too, so there's usually a big volunteer drive beforehand for people who are good at origami. Origami? I'm good at origami.
Really?
Shane is too. Maybe you should work together. Shane gave me a tight-lipped smile. Somehow I didn't think that would be happening.
Hey, speaking of, I swear
you rejected 10 girls last festival season. I mean, that's nothing compared to me, naturally, but there were so many girls with broken hearts. Even I couldn't mend them all. I thought I heard, like, new job is right now, but it wasn't it. You still hung up on your English girlfriend? Shane flinched, visibly taken aback, and then he shrugged. I don't talk to her anymore. Oh, Shane, I just want you to be happy, that's all. He wiped away a fake tear. Shane grimaced. How great would it be if someone asked me, maybe even if one of the normal boots guys did? No, I doubted that would ever happen. They were only letting me sit there because they physically assaulted me. I sighed and cut my beefcake with a plastic knife. So, any girls in mind, fellas? Beside me, Mai shifted nervously. Her eyes kept flicking from Jared to her french fries. She looked like a child who stole several cookies. Jared spread his arms out and raised an eyebrow. A god waiting for names to fall into his lap. I'm thinking of going solo this year, to be honest. Yeah, same. Man, you guys are boring. You guys aren't much better, man. I am on another level compared to you guys. I've already got my choice picked out. There was a quiet clattering next to me. Mai had dropped your fork. Yeah, I'm sure you have, and it'll probably be a new choice tomorrow. Jared flipped his hair with his hand. You know me so well. There's only so much time to make so many different girls' dreams come true. I must find the one who is the most in need. So it's not even about which ones you like, huh? Nope. Jared's kind of a dick, man. And you make fun of me. Just then, the warning bell rang. It was time to head back to class. As everyone got up to toss their trays, I stood up and, overwhelmed with a sudden burst of feeling, shouted, "Thank you for letting me and Mai eat lunch with you today. I really appreciate it." Yeah, thanks. Hana was having a terrible day, and you guys cheered her up. So, see you guys again tomorrow, same time? Mai tilted her head, eyes twinkling. Mai, Paul said we could only sit with them today. That's cool. Paul waved a hand in dismissal, almost dropping his tray with the other. The cafeteria is really crowded, and we have extra room at our table. People are too afraid to sit with us or something. Well, we did kick a girl yesterday. Very true. All of them shrugged at the same time, then left the room, moving in unison like a team of synchronized swimmers. Jared dumped his tray and jogged to catch up with them. As soon as they were out of earshot, Mai took Mai hands in hers and jumped up and down. You did it, Hana. We get to sit at the popular table. I've been trying to do that for 2 years, and you did it in 2 days. That's the power of a main character. She dropped our hands and made a jokingly, I think, angry face. Main characters have all the fun. All right, I'm going to go ahead and just stop it here. You guys, I only need one save data. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and end it here, you guys. Thanks for watching me. If you're watching this on Twitch, thanks for watching me live. If you guys are getting this on YouTube, go ahead and like, subscribe, share, all of that stuff. Hope you guys enjoyed the gameplay. Actually, let me go ahead and... Asagao Academy, the Normal Boots Club. Yeah, that's going to be it. So I'll go ahead and see you guys later. And... have a good night.